Eperitus put a hand on his shoulder and pulled him back. The ungainly prince, with whom he had shared so many hardships, looked at him, and there was anger in his eyes. But in that same moment, Eperitus handed him Iphitus's bow and a single arrow he had taken from the quiver. Odysseus snatched them from him and in an instant had fitted the arrow and was aiming it at Polytherses. Silence fell in the hall. Polytherses's eyes were wide with terror as he dragged Penelope in front of him to act as a shield against Odysseus's arrow. The four Taphians strained their bowstrings even further and waited only for a word from their leader. Meanwhile, Odysseus focused his concentration on Penelope and Polytherses. Penelope met his eyes and nodded imperceptibly. Odysseus whispered a prayer to Apollo for the sureness of his aim, then released the arrow from his fingertips. The darkness in the hall and the shimmering heat from the flames obscured the usurper of his father's throne and made his aim almost impossible. Indeed, very few could have hit such a mark. Teucer, possibly. Philoctetes also, but only with the magical arrows that Heracles had given him. Apollo, certainly, but with Iphitus's great horn bow, Odysseus was as deadly as any archer in Greece, and the arrow flew from his fingers straight into Polytherses's left eye. It passed through his brain and killed him before he could even think to cut his captive's throat. The Spartan princess stepped free of the dead man's hold, and the corpse collapsed in the dirt behind her. In the same instant, the Taphian bowstrings shivered the air in the great hall. One of their arrows nicked Odysseus's forehead, and another his upper arm. The third missed completely, but the fourth thumped into his thigh, making him shout in pain. Eperitus drew his sword and charged towards the enemy archers, but at that moment Mentes burst in through the twin doors, followed by Antiphus and a group of Ithacans. The Taphian held up his hand and ran to the center of the hall.